panel discussion. The topic of the panel is tech applications to recharge business. And let me just give you a little bit of context before I dive into the panel. The public spotlight is often on the consumer-facing side of internet apps in India, but what happens on the business-to-business side of consumer internet platforms is something that we want to discuss today. How has technology enhanced startup progress to help partners increase business? And what are the new requirements for startups to help the business of offline partners grow? To find out, we have five leading online platforms in India, and I'm going to introduce you to each of the leaders from these platforms. Join me in welcoming Amit Jindalwad, who is the VP Product and Engineering at Flipkart. We have Ankit Khanna, who is the Chief Product Officer at Make My Trip. Sachin Jangal, who is the CTO and co-founder at Goki. We have Mohit Maheshwari, who is the VP Marketing and Growth at Nestaway. And Mitesh Agarwal, who is the Director of Consumer Engineering at Google Cloud. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us today on this panel. I want to begin by asking you, Amit, about the scale at which Flipkart operates. We know the number of merchants that you have under your wing. And of course, the business with the merchants must have been challenging over the last 18 months, especially with the pandemic panning out. So tell us a little bit about how the journey's been and how your interaction has been with sellers in the marketplace.
Thanks for the question and thanks for having me on the panel. Well, Flipkart's core mission is developing a shared value in the ecosystem and helping digitize India through tech-led innovation. And we have been working very closely with the seller MSME ecosystem on bringing them to the fold of e-commerce. We have one of the largest marketplaces in India. And now we have about 3.75 lakh sellers on our platform. And our stated objective is to be at 4.2 lakh, and we are on track on that goal. So it's a fairly large scale marketplace. And especially in the last 12 to 18 months, going through the pandemic, what we have seen is sellers who are wanting to do business, both for their business continuity as well as riding the broader growth through internet and e-commerce adoption, have really embraced e-commerce. And we have been working with them through this journey, and we have led like several innovations, starting from how do we make sure they can onboard and list their products on our platform effortlessly, how they can grow and sustain their business, how they can improve their cost efficiencies, how can they, when they want to, let's say, in a festive period, they want to disproportionately scale the business, how do they get financing? We have a program called Growth Capital, which is specifically designed for that. So we have done a lot of innovation in this world on bringing these sellers to the forefront. And we have seen very, very interesting success stories on our platform. We also work with Kiranas and a lot of sort of mom and pop stores for both driving our business as well as working with them as our delivery partners. So we have a 360-degree strategy on sort of working with the broader ecosystem on bringing e-commerce to our consumers.
Right, interesting perspective out there, Ankit. I want to come to you to understand a little bit about how your engagement with hotels has been. While Amit spoke about sellers on the marketplace, you have a lot of engagement with hotels on your platform. So tell us a little bit about how did Make My Trip make it work?
For us, it was, it was absolutely zero when COVID happened. And then we have seen ups and downs all through the journey. So it was quite tough because on one side, obviously, there was limited consumer demand or there was no consumer demand. And on the other hand, hoteliers were struggling, and the struggle was varying from one hotel to another, depending on their scale, whether it's a chain hotel, independent hotel, leisure versus business, one city versus another city. And till today also, it is a bumpy ride and things are not getting settled down. I think, one good part with our engagement with hoteliers was that both the parties, us and hoteliers, were very, very consumer focused, even in bad times. And I will come to it why I'm saying so. So when us and hoteliers continually talking to each other, even when the demand was zero or when the demand was coming back, we just started looking at that what the consumer wants. And some of the key things that we were able to drive together were as follows. One, we had to build a program called My Safety, which actually helped us to certify all the hotels which are following certain guidelines as and when people are going to stay over there. And there we took third-party help. We devised our own mechanism to build a right certificate mechanism so that the consumer feel absolutely comfortable in getting into that hotel whenever he's going to that property. Second, we focus a lot on flexibility. I think that is probably the biggest shift which has happened in the travel industry. I mean, as consumer is not used to paying extra for getting the flexibility in place. So, and we are not used to, and the airlines and the hotels were not used to this kind of scale of cancellation in the last moment. But I think hotels were the first one to realize. And then we built a lot of engagement and figuring it out that what is the best policy with respect to date change and refund or last minute cancellation. And we felt that the hoteliers were very, very open because they also realized that in these difficult times or in these ever-changing times, just going ahead with one kind of policy will not work. That's number two. Number three, at least for the good news, at least coming from travel industry, is that the online penetration of travel has gone up in this difficult time, which is has been the case for every commerce platform, whether digital or product commerce. But for us, it was slightly difficult in the last few years because travel is still not a absolute need for the consumer, right? It somewhere comes below in the priority when you think about spending money or when you think about onboarding onto any new journey, right? So we again, there, the good part worked for us that consumer also started realizing the value of paying a little more even if they want to stay in a decent property. So that means that the supply of the hotels came back very, very effectively in premium or sub-premium or ultra-premium segment, but budget is still needs to see the recovery. And the last bit, I think we work together in figuring it out the right balance between their profit and our profit and keeping the consumer pocket in mind. I think earlier it used to be, I would say, slightly more that on certain hotels, on certain brands, we used to have a different relationship, but in our uncertain, there is something else. But now everyone realized that if we want to bring back the consumer, we have to let go certain bits and pieces from our pocket and let it flow to the consumer. I think all required absolutely in-hand discussion with them. And by the way, travel industry is also one industry where in-person interaction has always been the key with hoteliers. But that also changed. Now hoteliers are very comfortable in working virtually, in working digitally. It's not the end consumer whose online penetration has gone up. I think hotelers themselves, their staff, their revenue manager, their GM, everyone is very much willing to drive the digital penetration in the way even they work. I think all these changes has brought us well. I mean, Omicron is there, but I still feel that domestic travel is pretty much 90-95% back.
Right, let's hope that things get better going forward.
Yeah.
I think, Sachin, a little bit about Boki. You know, a lot of people don't know that the Boki Care ecosystem exists. And, you know, y'all have done a lot to scale it up. So how has it been, you know, in terms of growth and scale? And if you could tell us a little bit about how the whole ecosystem has scaled up over the last couple of months.
Yeah, sure. So I think let me start a little bit background on the Goki and, you know, what we thought when we were building Goki. So essentially, you know, Goki is a smart preventive healthcare ecosystem, which brings in the latest, you know, technology and the old, you know, coaching methodology together into one place with a mix of, you know, gamification and motivation in the whole ecosystem. While we all know that, you know, users and people definitely require motivation as well as guidance for achieving their health goals, that is something which was very, very key for Goki when it started working. So we thought of, you know, various of other platform. We have seen other platforms, apps, as well as wearable, which gives a lot of insights to users, as well as there is a lot of data and content which is already available through the digital medium, through online, for users to you know, consume, as well as be more aware of the of their health needs and all. But at the end of the day, a lot of our users and a lot of, you know, as large, you know, users don't really do what they need to do. What they lack is fundamentally a guidance and a somebody to personally monitor them and motivate them. And that's what we are into. And, you know, we are into providing motivation and guidance and making yourself, you know, forced to for a change. That's what the Goki stands for. So again, as Amit and was mentioning, Ankit was mentioning, during the pandemic, you know, not everybody is pretty much aware of one word, which is, you know, immunity. And that's where, you know, the whole holy grail is to build yourself as an immunity. But because, again, large country like India does not have really, you know, infrastructure to support the population what we have. We have seen that kind of breakdown during the pandemic, where, you know, all the healthcare system was pretty much broken down and under stress and all. So this is what Goki has started with, thinking of, you know, how do we prevent illness? How do we prevent, you know, people to go to, you know, doctors as well as hospital? How do we, you know, delay that need? So that's the medium what Goki has selected for building a solution in the ecosystem. What essentially, as I mentioned, that, you know, what we have been able to do was to combine you know, technology like wearable, which is, you know, again, something which people today finding as a start point of their health journey. Everybody is, you know, very much inclined and aware that, you know, let me buy a wearable and start tracking my step. And actually, that's the fundamental of, you know, becoming more healthier and conscious, that you start monitoring your activity, steps and sleep. So that data getting combined with a coach, you know, and the care team is what, you know, Goki was able to provide. And we have seen really a good success. And during the pandemic, this entire thing was really, really taken, you know, a jump into the requirement, as well as, you know, Amit from Flipkart can agree to that, you know, during the pandemic, a lot of users and a lot of their users have also gone into home exercise. And, you know, that category itself has grown a lot. So awareness was always there. There was, you know, lack of motivation, which was driven or given by our coaches, our care team. And that's what we thought that, you know, this will really help, while there are other solutions which are fantastic in terms of technology, in terms of product, which uses machine learning, artificial intelligence to deliver user the nudge or the, you know, feedback. But at the end of the day, you know, we human always think that, you know, and know that there's a, on the other end, there's a AI, there's a machine which is telling us, and or probably my phone is, or the app on my phone is telling me to do something, versus when a human who connects with you, personalize your requirement, and, you know, tells you to do something, and then we keep, you know, working with you on a daily basis, is something is much, much more effective. And we have seen that, you know, that requirement has grown tremendously, not just for the wellness, physical wellness and fitness, but also mental wellness also, because people again require, you know, emotional support, emotional motivation. And during the pandemic, when everybody was working from home or was facing issues, and, you know, thinking of a you know, situation where you are locked down in a home, it was always unthoughtable, or, you know, something which people have not imagined. So think of those scenarios where, you know, again, you know, taking care of your work at your home, as well as taking care of yourself, was very, very demanding. And that during that time, the care team definitely has really played a good role. And we have seen, you know, India becoming more and more healthier, as well as health conscious. And what we thought, you know, will take eventually some time, was accelerated during the pandemic. And we have seen the growth of our services, our offerings, much higher.
Right, interesting perspective out there, Sachin. Mohit, I want to understand from you how you actually worked with property owners at this point in time to sort of scale it up, and, you know, what is the kind of base that you have on your platform at Destiway?
Right. Thanks, Priya. So, you know, since the pandemic, it's been one of the toughest years for us as a company. And what is ironic is even though we are in the business of, you know, helping people find homes and work from home became prevalent, our own business sort of took a, you know, little bit of a downturn. A couple of, you know, learnings that we had over the, you know, we've had over the last 15, 18 months or so is that we saw our industry sort of transition from a do it for me sort of a mentality to, you know, I can do it myself mentality. So we saw, for example, a lot of our owners used to require our help for onboarding their houses on our platform, etc. But, you know, we created technology, we created tools for them to list their properties on their own, you know, shoot property videos, etc. And, you know, give it to us in a manner where we could do that, you know, using the software tools that we had built out for them. And we saw very, very good sort of response from our property owners, primarily stemming from the need of minimizing physical contact with the external folks and, you know, trying to list their properties online directly with us, right? The other thing, you know, that we also saw is on the demand side as well, right? A lot of people initially used to say that, you know, nobody's going to book a home online without sort of visiting physically. But, you know, we launched something called as virtual tours. And today, over the last, you know, 12 months or so, we have the largest library of, you know, videos of homes in India. We have close to some 10,000 houses where we have actual video tours of houses available with us. And we've seen almost double digit contribution coming from where, you know, people are looking for properties online now, sort of booking their house directly by, you know, doing virtual tours of these properties and going ahead and booking these properties, which, you know, a couple of years back, you know, we would have laughed off the idea itself. So technologically, a lot has happened. And, you know, we believe that the industry has sort of advanced by close to about 5 to 7 odd years in just these last, you know, 10 to 12 months or so, right? And, you know, in terms of what other tools have we helped our property owners with, what has also happened is rentals have gotten revised, right? A lot of reverse migration has happened. And, you know, specifically, we were present in metro cities till almost March 2020, and we realized there's a lot of people who are moving back to smaller towns or closer home, right? So what we did at that point in time is we also sort of expanded our operations by partnering with a lot of local entrepreneurs, etc., and launched in, say, about 5 to 7 more cities in where we did not have operations in, because we saw that the tier two rental demand also sort of climbing up. And a lot of property owners from these cities reaching out to us to sort of rent out their properties, you know, since the pandemic happened. So that's another trend that we saw emerging. And another interesting thing that is also happening in the sector is that a lot of outskirts, for example, Devanahalli in Bangalore, you know, areas like that, where people were reluctant to sort of move to and, you know, work out of, the demand has sort of started increasing because a lot of people who are working, say, once or twice, you know, a day from in a week from office were okay to sort of move on the outskirts and look for, you know, bigger sized homes, etc. So that's something that we saw that, you know, changing. So in terms of, you know, second question, Priya, in terms of scale, we manage close to about 45,000 odd properties today across 20 odd cities in India. And, you know, we've helped about 2.5 lakh people find a home in the last, you know, 5 to 6 years or so since we have been in operation.
Right, Mitesh, I want to come to you to understand a little bit about how consumer-facing businesses at this point in time can use cloud services to improve their operational efficiency. If you could give us some perspective on that, please.
Thank you, Priya. It's been amazing hearing stories from a variety of spaces here, right, from Flipkart to Goki to Nestaway, you know, and to Make My Trip, right? It's like a nice, unique conundrum. And there's a fundamental learning, you know, from each one of those. What I hear is that, you know, there have been massive constraints, but only when there are constraints does agility show up. So clearly, you know, an underlying theme around that is that, you know, each of these businesses have to be agile. And I think the pandemic had really made us constrained with the way we interacted with our employees, the way we interacted with our customers, and how we provided services to them, whether you are doing a B2B service or you're doing a B2C service. So that's the first part around how, you know, cloud services could be agile. And clearly we saw a lot of customers coming to us and saying, hey, can you move our existing workloads to the cloud because we can't anymore pay, you know, a bunch of services, especially in the traditional enterprises. Digital natives, luckily, who are on this panel, were always on the cloud in one way or the other, right? But they rapidly accelerated a bunch of movements as well. So that's the first part. The second part that we started seeing is how could we provide flexibility? How could we, you know, take cost out of the equation? So, you know, we heard Ankit speak about Make My Trip, right? Around the amount of effect that I've had, or Mohit speak about, you know, how while they were helping others find homes, right, they had to really start figuring out how to do things, right? So one of the things that we really started getting folks to ask us is, can you provide us flexibility with the way, you know, cloud services can go up and go down, right? And the final thing that we started hearing a lot of our customers is kind of true to our mission statement. So if you hear Google's mission statement, it's organizing the world's information and making it universally accessible and useful. So I kind of look at this as three different elements. Organizing the world's information is all around data. Making it universally accessible is all around building an API ecosystem from a cloud perspective. And really having it useful is where we start talking about artificial intelligence. So to me, you know, these are no more buzzwords. I think almost everybody here wants to run a data-driven business because you want to rely on data, the way you're collecting this, and how can you, you know, do remote services. The second part is how can you, you know, you organize this much better and provide insights, you know, and really start making it universally accessible, which is the API ecosystem. We saw a lot of work around Apigee, which is a unique API ecosystem that we've got. A number of traditional enterprises, a number of, you know, digital natives that are here, you know, starting to, you know, look at Apigee as the way you connect both your internal ecosystem in IT as well as your external partners. And finally, start to use ML models to start building that, you know, slightly more intelligent data fabric where everybody had a lot of data, but they didn't have the right insights. So in my mind, these cloud services really were the entry points, right? Whether they were infrastructure related services, data related services, or API related services. Back to you, Priya.
All right. Thanks for that, Nitesh. I want to come to you, Amit, to understand a little bit about how Flipkart has worked with sellers to introduce new products and features on the platform, considering that, you know, over the last year, there have always been changes, real-time development that happened. So how did you go about it, and what are the kind of features that you introduced for sellers on this?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, right? So just to put things in perspective, about 30% of the sellers, of all sellers that we have on platform, got added in just last 1 year. And we've been in the business for the last 15 years, right? And if you look at the transacting seller base, it's even like the share is even bigger. It's about 40%, right? Our ability to scale our platforms during this time was tested because we were just seeing enormous growth happening, both in terms of onboarding, activation, growth, and the entire lifecycle management on our platform, right? And at the same time, what we were seeing is that the actors coming into the system were fairly heterogeneous, right? From small businesses who are coming online for the first time, or brands who are scaling their presence online or expanding geographically. Even their online maturity was completely different, right? Someone who is doing it really for the first time versus someone who is an expert who really wants to scale the business. The ecosystem was also evolving rapidly. Just to give you guys some flavor, right? I'm sure you all know the government introduced the concept of essentials, right? And essential items also were defined differently for different locations. Now, our teams literally across the board, right? Catalog, fulfillment, seller platform, customer support, had to make these changes in rapid time to ensure that the sellers are able to participate in selling the right kind of products in right geographies, and customers have the best possible experience in all the constraints that we are operating. In fact, in several occasions, it meant we had to, in fact, make, I think, about 6-7 times changes just over the weekend, right? Given how rapidly the definitions of some of these constructs were changing, right? But just to give you some broader perspective, right? I think, as I said, when we look at from enabling essentials to looking how do we orchestrate the right fulfillment services, again, given a bunch of red and orange zones and all that sort of classification, to let's say more recently, right, when there was festive period and this was a massive festive period for the broader ecosystem and us after a fairly long lockdown or sort of a suppressed business, we had to enable services which could A, make sure that the cash movement for the sellers is fairly fast. So we had a program where the sellers could get next day payment for all their orders. As I've alluded to in the past, I think growth capital is very, very important for sellers who want to dream big and invest into their areas and make sure that they're ready for the kind of scale that online commerce is able to drive to them. In fact, here we made sure that for them to have rapid and hassle-free service, we actually deeply integrated to a bunch of lending partners. From application to dispersal, everything was done automatically. We also did very structured interventions. For example, we had a 45-day learning and development program for all these new sellers getting into the festive period. So the broader point is, how do we make sellers aware of what are the consumer preferences, what are the different constraints that they need to efficiently operate in? How do we let them know the shopping patterns and help our sellers in general with all the right insights and tooling to make sure that they can come online and operate at scale? So these are some of the things that we did in the last 18 months, which we are extremely proud of. Looking back, I think as Manish said, right, what we have been able to do for the broader ecosystem is just phenomenal. I think we have, the acceleration that we have seen and the acceptance that we have seen from traditional sellers to come online and really scale their business, really think big, right? Don't think for your mohalla or your city, right? Think national, think India scale is what we have seen. And we are very proud to see their business growing leaps and bounds.
Right. Ankit, I want to understand in terms of analytics, what are the kind of tools that are available to hotel owners at this point in time that you offer on your platform?
Yeah, sure. So on this one, we have a separate product called Extranet. I mean, for the lack of a very complicated word, which is like a hotel supplier platform where so we have two kind of hotels. One is independent hotels, where number of hotels will be in the range of 1 to 5. And then we have big chain, both international and national, who work with us to sell their inventory. And within large chains also, the way national chains behave is very different from the way international chains behave, because they rely far more on technology rather than anyone else. So two big changes happened for us as far as this part of the ecosystem is concerned. One, as I was saying earlier, the digital adoption or the inclination to adopt everything digitally has gone up by leaps and bounds. Because when everyone was sitting at home and the people who were on the ground, we used to interact with these hotels on pretty much daily basis, if not daily, weekly basis. I think they realized the power of doing everything digitally. And for us, it may be a small shift, but for these people, it was a big shift, right? Because that's not what they were used to. So in this product, we always had these capabilities of analytics available to them, just to see how, at what price point they should sell, how the inventory will move up in the next 7 to 10 days. And by the way, they are also very, they're very good in understanding their ecosystem, because it's not that they sell inventory through us. Offline hotels segment is still very big, right? So it was also a two-way communication. But I think what three things that we introduced in this time frame. One, we helped them to understand the COVID guidelines better. I think because when all this happened, there was news of some new guideline or new chain day on day, right? And their ability to comprehend this thing and then implement it in a hotel which can have anywhere from 20 rooms to 600 rooms is a Herculean task. It seems easy from outside, but I mean, imagine just shaking their entire machinery to work in a certain direction, and then 2 days later the government comes up with something else, and then you have to move away. And then reaching out to the consumer to reflect the same thing was a huge challenge. So we made sure that we are able to help them. Second thing, we changed or maybe introduced extra analytics to help them understand better. So when recovery started happening after wave one, or when things started opening first, I think we were the ones who can help them understand that how the search pattern of the individual is moving from pre-COVID to post-COVID, how the source cities are changing, where people are traveling. It seemed very natural that people started doing more drivable destinations as compared to flight when post-recovery happened. People started taking more breaks, but of lesser duration as compared to going for a week or 2 weeks. Vacations or staycations for work was a big thing. Now, how to price it, how to organize it was another area. The length of stay, as I was saying, in case of staycation, and also the number of people, we also saw that more and more families are now traveling as compared to couples or maybe couples with only kids. I think the notion of family eating together, staying together went up in the COVID, and that started reflecting in travel also. So those insights, I think at an aggregate level or maybe at a national level, we were able to provide, because earlier these were very limited to a particular locality in which the hotel was located. So that was number two. Number three, one area of travel segment which saw a remarkable upswing in the last 2 to 3 years, and especially after COVID, is an alternate accommodation, which is a direct, you can say, competition or a complementary stay option as far as hotel is concerned, which includes your cottages, villas, homestays, and everything. And these owners are pretty much individual owners, and their level of digital adoption varies from 0 to 100. Like, there are many people who are very, I wouldn't say who belong to upper middle class, they have multiple properties, and they started realizing that that's a revenue stream. Right. And a lot of small-time homeowners started venturing into it. So we have built an absolutely digital onboarding product for them, which is very different from extranet that we have built for hotels, so that they can really start selling their home or cottage or villa in just a matter of 2 to 3 minutes or 2 to 3 hours. So these are the three things we did and changed remarkably for them.
All right, thanks for that, Ankit. I want to bring both of you, Sachin, as well as Mohit, into this conversation to ask you what's the way forward in terms of scaling up features for the whole B2B chain and what this really means for both the companies. Sachin, you also have a whole host of trainers as well on the platform. So how would you service this chain as well, and what kind of products and features can we expect down the line?
So again, we built the whole platform thinking of in a mind that, you know, we will be working more like a, you know, Flipkart or Amazon of the world, where, you know, we'll be a marketplace of service providers who wants to offer their services to our users. So the entire, platform was built in a mind to keep scale, as well as, you know, not just, you know, adapting more service providers or, you know, coaches to our platform, but also to help them to scale, to cater more users on platform. So on the back end, what we were able to do was to build a analytics platform, which helps them to analyze data which is coming from all the users, which is, you know, your daily, your fitness data, your, you know, different type of, you know, data which you are putting on the system, whether it's a blood report or a food meal, you are logging into the app. So all this thing, you know, gets into the system, and, you know, the coaches are able to see recommendation as well as actionable insights on their smart dashboard, which helps them to scale. So when we started, when we were building all this tools for our coaches, we were having a scale or a capacity of, you know, doing 50 to 60 users per coach, which scaled up to 250 to 300 users per coach. So again, the idea was to empower and give more tools to our coaches to, in order to, cater more and more, while not losing the personalization and focus, because again, it's the health, what they're working with the users. What we have also seen during the pandemic and before also, we were pretty much ready with this, was that, you know, demand of, doing digital while we are consuming a lot of other things on whether it's a e-commerce, whether it's a searching for a hotel or searching for a property, users are also looking for health and fitness online. So we built a fantastic platform which we called as Goki Play, where a lot of from morning 7:30 till 11 o'clock there is continuous classes, live classes happening on various topics. As well as, the users are able to join in at their own pace, at their own need. And they are able to interact with, experts and subject matter experts on the platform to ask and clear their doubts and get more aware of the health and practice. What we were able to also do was, again, help, thanks to, all the cloud platform as well as technologies, brought by Google, Microsoft and AWS, we were able to scale and build all these products very, very faster. We were also able to build a live streaming platform for workouts. So a trainer who was not able to work during the pandemic because of the gym being shut down, they were able to utilize our platform to come online and do their classes, workout classes with our users using the platform. So that was really, really helpful. And majority of our users who are coming, and they have their own pace of working as well as their own need as well as personalization. So right from being a casual fitness and person to a chronic condition as well as disease management, that is something which we were able to build on the platform. So our coaches, again, who are highly qualified, again, during the pandemic, they were not able to really work. There were a lot of people who are working with, or institution or organization, which is again driven more in the physical format. So they were able to utilize our platform, and across cities and across states, we have seen that our coaches were able to deliver their care to our users using the platform. So I think overall what we have seen the growth wise, the technologies are really enablers, and the way the product and product has evolved during the pandemic as well as during the course of time has really, really fulfilled. But what essentially I was also able to see was that more and more users are able to adopt this technology as well as this form of services. We have seen that India has become the fastest growing and the number one in terms of UPI and digital payment. Likewise, we have seen health as well as fitness and digital health and digital fitness has really grown in India, and a lot of people are now becoming more aware of platform like Goki in order to take care of their health and condition. So I think overall, in terms of scaling, definitely technology has really, really helped. At the same time, awareness as well as need of this type of platform as well as healthcare system has also evolved a lot. We also have a platform on our platform. We also have coaches as well as doctors on our platform. So we have seen a lot of people who are coming to our platform, not for an event or a clinical disorder, but they are coming for a general wellness. So what they are interestingly discussing with their doctors are not about, what they have a cold or fever. What they are talking largely about is how does they live healthy and active lifestyle. So that is a lot of conversation which our doctors are having a conversation with them. And again, it falls into primary functions, primary focus areas, what we are doing. And again, it's not a rocket science. It's something which is a very, very basic about, nutrition, sleep and happiness, what our coaches as well as our doctors are able to talk about to them. So in large, a platform like Goki has really evolved over a period of time from 10 coaches giving services to few thousands of users. Now we have thousands of coaches who are able to give their service on digital platform to lakhs of users on our platform.
Sure. Thanks for that, Sachin. Mohit, two quick points from you in terms of how the scenario will pan out going forward, and what kind of features are you looking at adding onto your platform for property owners?
Sure. Priya, the way the industry is going, like I said, we see a lot more adoption of digital tools happening across the industry. So, for example, we built an in-house tool called Localytics to to, you know, help our property owners make better decisions in respect to, you know, the rentals that they can, you know, demand in a particular locality basis of type of the house, right? Multiple sort of factors coming in and helping them make decisions better in order to, you know, push up their occupancy and also, you know, reduce the time it takes to rent out their property, right? So a lot of analytics is sort of going to come into the industry, as we now see adoption of digital tools happening across the board. From Nestaway's perspective, what we are now realizing is that, from a two-sided marketplace where we only had, say, owners and tenants, you know, we are now sort of trying to transition ourselves into like a market network, really, where, you know, outside of these owners and tenants, we also have real estate agents and, you know, we have painters and, you know, electricians and plumbers, etc. All sorts of these, you know, auxiliary service providers, which are critical to, shifting of a home or moving when, you know, somebody's moving from X place to Y place, right? And we're sort of trying to build this ecosystem and get all of these people together and, create a seamless SaaS solution with specialized workflows and specialized requirements in order to cater to this entire journey of renting, because, you know, the life cycle of, renting a property is so long, right? From, you know, somebody trying to onboard their property to finding a tenant, to that tenant actually moving into the property, staying on that property, and, you know, then sort of move out and then, you know, a new tenant walking in. So we have even built tools to sort of streamline a lot of payment flows. For example, earlier it used to take us maybe, you know, more than 10 to 15 days to even refund the tenant's amount when they used to move out of the property. But we, during the pandemic, realizing the criticality of the situation, we launched a feature called Instant Deposit Refund, which allowed us to sort of, you know, refund the deposits of tenants within 24 or 48 hours of them moving out of the property. So a lot of such innovations are going to come in. Real estate was probably the last bastion in terms of, you know, technology sort of getting adopted. So COVID has really fast-tracked it, and we're really excited about what's, you know, ahead for us.
All right, Mitesh, I'm going to come to you for the last word to understand how, you know, these changing needs of all the businesses can be addressed and how Google Cloud's engineering has helped collaborate and, bring together better products and services for each of these companies. So if you could just sum it up for us and tell us the way forward, Mitesh.
Thank you, Priya. I think each of them have very unique business problems, and the good news about digital and cloud is that they're no more buzzwords. I think, Mohit said that, you know, their entire industry that they are in, you know, got accelerated by 5 to 7 years. And that's what we hear from everyone, like the approach that Goki has taken that Sachin mentioned, right? Like they want to help consumers while most of the others are just trying to sell. Right, you're helping customers, and therefore there's a lot more education involved in the tech needs of the customer. If you look at Flipkart, you know, obviously they're a giant the way they've put in the amount of tech that is there, but they constantly need to, you know, there's new pressure every day, right? There is a new third player that's kind of knocking on their doors. There is a traditional player trying to knock on their doors. So you've got to constantly start innovating. And it's the same thing with Make My Trip, right? As travel comes back, you know, experiences are very different. So in summary, the way we look at it is that, you know, there are three kinds of solutions that we start looking at. At the core of all of this has to be security, which I think is a very, very fundamental theme, you know, out there, because especially when you're running offline. The second part is really being able to have the ability to collaborate with your employees and with your customers. What do I mean by that? Look at developer productivity with each of the organizations here. So, now developers need to, you know, be able to collaborate without coming to the office or in a hybrid mode, right? So how do we help you with developer productivity? So that's the second part, therefore collaboration as well. The third part is really getting the agility and flexibility that I spoke about around data, around infrastructure, and around APIs. So in summary, I think all of these areas are what Google can, you know, obviously help you with, especially Google Cloud. And you always have interacted with the Google ecosystem around ads, search, YouTube, Google Pay, and so on. And we have fantastic integrations into Google Cloud for all of these products. So we are there to help, obviously, and we'll do lots of offline discussions with many of you that we've continued to do. Back to you, Priya.
All right. On that note, thank you very much, panelists, for this enriching discussion. I think there are lots of takeaways, and as Mitesh very rightly put it, it is an ecosystem to collaborate with, and we're looking forward to that kind of collaboration going forward. So thank you very much for being a part of this panel, and thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you. Yeah. Be safe.